Let me introduce myself. My name is Allison Lisdis. I serve as Assistant to the Bishop and Director of Advocacy in the Southeastern Synod. I come to you with greetings from Bishop Strickland and staff. I am very excited to be here with Deacon Ross Murray, who has written the book Everyday Advocate. I'm going to open us with a prayer, and then I'm going to do a little intro of Deacon Ross, and then I'm going to let him take over. I'm thrilled you all are here. Thank you for making the time to be here this evening. Please join me in a word of prayer. Grant us, O God, that your holy and life-giving spirit may move every human heart, that the barriers dividing us may crumble, suspicions disappear, and hatred cease, and that with our divisions healed, we might live in justice and peace. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
600 feet at the traffic circle. Take the second exit. Stay on Thimble Shoals Boulevard.
If everyone could be muted, that would be great. Until I'm sure there'll be an opportunity for questions if you have questions. But if you could stay muted until then, that would be great. I'd love to see more of your faces if you want to be seen. Let me introduce Deacon Ross. Ross Murray is the Vice President at the GLAAD Media Institute, which provides activism, spokesperson, and media engagement training and education for LGBTQ and allied community members, the media industry and advocacy organizations desiring to deepen their media impact. Ross uses the best practices perfected by GLAAD to train a new generation of advocates in order to accelerate acceptance for LGBTQ people, as well as other marginalized communities. Ross is also a founder and director of the Naming Project, a faith-based camp for LGBTQ youth and their allies. Ross has secured national media interest in stories that bring examples of LGBTQ equality across diverse communities in America. He specializes in the relationship between religion and LGBTQ people. He is the author of two books, one of which we will be discussing tonight. And the other one is called Made Known Loved, Developing LGBTQ Inclusive Youth Ministry, Including Youth Ministry. He has written in numerous and appeared in numerous media outlets and is a podcast producer. Ross is an ordained deacon in the ELCA with a specific calling to advocate for LGBTQ people and to bridge the LGBTQ faith and communities. And I'm thrilled he was able to take time and be with us tonight. Ross, if you would like to take it over, it's all yours.
Thank you, Allison. And thank you all for spending time with us tonight. I know that when I'm trying to be more honest when people talk to me and says, how are you doing? And now I sometimes say things like, there's a lot going on. That's been my standard answer. And that is, you know, that is, it's personally, it's in my professional life. It's in the bigger, wider world, the nation, the world. And recognizing and acknowledging that is always incredibly important. And moments like this, I hope, can be restorative, rejuvenating, give some kind of direction forward for what it is we can do. I also really am excited that I will be, if you don't know this, I will be joining you at the Synod Assembly in what, about 6 weeks, I guess. And
not that I'm counting, but yes.
Yeah. And get to spend time with you throughout the entire weekend, specifically getting to lead a Bible study. So what you're getting tonight is a little bit of a preview of what that will look like, although this is much more free-flowing, a little bit more discussion-based. Feel free to put questions and comments in the chat. I will also pause probably a few times just for questions and reactions and responses. Really want to make this an opportunity that can be as helpful for you as possible. I know, you know, you've been reading Everyday Advocate. This is what I'm mainly here to talk about, is the work that went into that book. And I will tell a couple stories just to kind of get started, that if you've read the book, you probably heard some of these themes sort of appear. But, you know, advocacy becomes this weird word. Activist is even more, can be sometimes jarring. And it's funny, for when I work at GLAAD, we're very much wordsmith type people. And even the nuances between being an activist and being an advocate, there can be different, you know, there's different pieces to that. But when I was writing this book, I'm still a church camper. Besides running the naming project, I usually end that week and then I will go join my family for family camp at the same place that I grew up at, the same camp that I went to as a child, the same one that I worked at in my college years. I'm back being a camper again. And we go as a family. My family, I will tell you, consists of my parents, me and my husband, my sister and her husband, and her two children. Two children, six adults. That's a pretty good ratio for family camp, in my opinion. And, you know, because it's family camp, it's a little bit more freewheeling. There's a lot more self-determination. What do you want to do, especially when you're grown up, which is really fun. So, you know, I've been talking over the course of the Bible study and sort of making these themes and talking about the fact that I've been working on a book that was about advocacy. And someone said, you should do this as one of the afternoon activities, like help talk about a discussion that can help people think about advocacy. So the two things came out of that conversation, and they both came from the same person. She is a lovely person, beautiful child of God. She's a member of my parents. She goes to the same church that my parents do in Northern Minnesota, and she is hilarious and tells funny stories. I will not out her any further than that. But the two things that she said is when I talked about, like, you know, I'm doing this book about advocacy and how people, everyday people, can become advocates. And her first question was, so do you just mean the thing where you stand outside of buildings holding signs and screaming into a bullhorn? That was her impression, right? As I said, advocate is, she has a picture of a protest and has that image. And you probably also have that mental image of what that's looked like. We've seen versions of those. That helped to inform me of what people think and what people feel when they hear the word advocacy. Right? And there is absolutely a place for rallies, for protests. There is a time and a place where people are feeling called to have to stand outside a building, holding signs and screaming into a bullhorn. And I will never discount that. However, I am an incredibly conflict avoidant person. And the idea of doing that gives me some level of agita. It's not that I don't do it. If there's times and ways and places that I have to be there, I will, because I feel it's important enough. And the one thing I think is incredibly important is to realize that everyday advocacy is something that gets incorporated into our lifestyle. And it takes a variety of gifts, the gifts and the skills and the sometimes the privileges that we've been given to be able to use that in order to make the world better. So as I, you know, even just to give people a definition of advocacy, it is the work that we do to try to make this world that God has created and given us a little bit better, a little bit easier. And it is, you know, it's the flip side of the direct service, the meeting the need, the solving the problem immediately for people. It's also working on the systems that we have created that create a lot of the problems that we have. And the second story I'll come up with the same comment, same person in the conversation. You know, I was telling my stories about my work at GLAAD, and GLAAD is a really large national LGBTQ organization. We do work a lot with media, so we often get a lot of media attention because of our media work. There's a big Hollywood division. I am not really part of that. I'm the unsexy side of GLAAD, I say. And even my husband talked about his work that we do here in New York about fiscal, state, budget, taxation, justice, making sure that people that have made millions and billions of dollars off of the state are paying their fair share so that we can make the state equitable and fair and affordable for everyone else. And so he was describing some of that work. And the same woman raised her hand and she said, yeah, but I can't do all that stuff that you do. And I'm never going to be at that level. And it's really funny. Again, I'm conflict avoidant. I don't think of myself as like that much or doing all that much stuff. I am tired and barely keeping up as it is. But I also realized in that conversation and from this woman's impressions in her comments, you know, when we think of advocacy and we think of activism, we sometimes think of, I'm going to call them larger than life, almost mythical creatures. They're not mythical because they're real, but maybe legendary creatures. People like the Martin Luther King Jr.'s or the Mahatma Gandhi's and the people, you know, that get held up and in some ways, especially after they have passed on and they have this legacy, sort of takes on almost a caricature of themselves, right? If you've seen this, you've probably seen critiques of on Martin Luther King Day, people can share all sorts of platitudes and pull up the favorite all-time quotes that he does and sometimes ignore the real, real struggle that he went through and the real difficulty that he had doing the work that he did, because now we have this idea of what he should be. And then we also say, but I can't, I'm not gonna do that. So the two things I wanna say to people too is that this really is, what can you do in terms of the gifts and the skills that God has given you? And what are the opportunities to be able to apply that? And some of that has to do with what are the things that you care about the most. This book was really structured in a way to be self-led. I don't tell you what issue to choose. There are a ton of issues that are out there. And there may be ones that touch you in a very particular way. And again, it could be economic justice. It could be anti-racism work. It could be work related to Israel and Gaza. It could be work that is related to environmental justice. There is so much that we need to do. And it's really going to take all of us to be able to do that. And so with that variety of gifts that we have, you think about, you know, what do I care about? What do I feel called to act upon? And then start to figure out what you can do with it. And again, we don't jump into the Martin Luther King model right away. We figure out how to do what we can do with the opportunity in the space that we have. The first recommendation is always get connected. Sometimes it feels like, especially if anyone here is rural, I don't know if people there are in a rural area, you can feel like you are the only person that thinks or cares about this issue. And sometimes it's almost like, it almost is like a dirty little secret. And you, when you realize that other people care about this and there are other people and organizations and networks that are doing this work, it makes it easier because you don't have to do and create things on your own. You don't have to build something out of nothing because there probably is another person, another organization, another somebody else who knows and cares about this. And they might not be local. They might be online. The great thing about the internet is we can find those organizations and we can take their resources. We can take their directives. We can take their actions and move those into, okay, what does that look like for me here? Steal the ideas of what I'm doing here in New York State and apply them to your state. It's fun. I get to talk to you. You're representing what, 4 different states here? So you can figure out how to do that application and use that, you know, in the best practice that's going to work for you. And then because this is advocacy for Christians, this is advocacy for people of faith, I want to also address the fact that this is motivated by our faith, right? This is motivated by our belief that that of the grace of God and whatever we do is going to be helpful. And if it's not enough, it is never enough. And so we also rely on the grace of God that we are being used in the right way and that God is going to be doing more, probably with other people, some of God's own direct action in some way to help bring about resolution. It doesn't stop us from trying, knowing that we can never completely fully solve the problem and we rely on the grace of God. When I do the Synod Assembly, I'm going to do a Bible study on one particular tactic that I will talk about. One thing that really has helped my advocacy outside of LGBTQ stuff, if you read this, you realize a lot of my work is LGBTQ, but I read a book called We Are Indivisible. And we actually joined an organization called Indivisible that has chapters all over the country. I live in Upper Manhattan, so there's an Indivisible Harlem. And Indivisible Harlem is the group that I'm a part of, but it's connected to this national organization. I will say politically, it's very progressive. I am a very progressive person. It's my side note. You don't have to be progressive to use these skills. In fact, one of the things Indivisible pointed out is the tactics and the skills that they were describing in their book was what these two, this couple, they both worked on Capitol Hill during the Tea Party years. And a lot of the book is, these are the tactics that we saw the Tea Party use. They're very, very effective. We should also be using those same tactics. So this is not about political affiliation. This is not about a liberal versus conservative thing. This is actually about the skills, right? And about what we can do because we know or we care about an issue in a particular way. But one of the things that Indivisible talks about is you need to be in touch with your elected leaders constantly. They should be hearing from you every day about something. Call their office, visit their office, go to their town halls, go to their public appearances, be a constant presence that they know and they see, and you're always, always, always talking about the issue that's important to you, right? And when I read that, it struck me that there's a very similar parable that Jesus told as well. And this is where the Bible study is going to come in. Jesus tells the parable of what gets called the widow and the unjust judge. And it says that there was a judge that neither feared God nor respected people. And every day this widow kept coming before the judge and saying, "Grant me justice against my opponent." I don't know what her opponent did to her. I don't know what justice actually meant in her case. I don't know what she was really asking for. And Jesus goes on and tells this parable and says, eventually the judge did grant her petition. Did the judge have a change of heart? Did the judge suddenly fear God and respect people? No. In fact, part of the rationale of what the judge says to him, his own self, is, even though I still don't fear God and I don't respect people, I am going to grant this widow her petition. Why? So that I can stop her from bugging me so much. And so she's not constantly come and wear me down. This showing up and being constant presence and contacting every single day, that persistence is the same kind of persistence that gets the widow whatever it is she needs in that particular moment. It also demonstrates that sometimes we can push people into action even if we're not going to change their heart or mind. Indivisible was also very clear about this. They said, you might, and this might be true for people that are on this call, you might be a person that has a certain set of values and your local or state or federal elected leaders don't necessarily agree with those values. Maybe you're of a political party and your elected leader is of a different party. Does that mean that they're a lost cause and you shouldn't contact them? No, you absolutely should contact them still every single day, constantly as they're doing their work. They need to be reminded that they have constituents that have a particular set of values, that they have constituents that care about an issue and constituents that wants them to act in a particular way. Sometimes that is effective, and Indivisible has said this. Sometimes it means that your elected leader, you know, they'll say nice things. They'll try to say stuff that makes you sound like you agree with them. And you have to be persistent and say, but what are you doing? What's the vote actually going to be? Are you going to take the action step that I want? And sometimes, you know, I'm trying to say this in a very nonpartisan way. If there's some issue that's coming down from your, let's say, oppositional party, something you don't agree with, you might be able to get your person from being a full-throated endorser of like, let's pass this law to do blah, 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 to maybe I'm not going to talk about it. Maybe I'm not going to be so full-throated. Or maybe I'm going to just hope that this gets withdrawn and somebody else takes care of it. And I don't have to put myself out there saying that I voted for something or that I voted against something. That is all kind of that like political calculation. But they need that pressure. They will not come to that decision on their own. They will come to that decision if they hear constantly their constituents and enough of their constituents care about that issue. And it doesn't mean they're going to convert. It doesn't mean they will still not fear God nor respect people. And so knowing and understanding that, and when they take the wrong action, you tell them that was the wrong action. If they take the right action, even if they're not with the political party that you're a part of, you still thank them for the action they did. And you do a little improv. You do a yes and. You say thank you for that thing that you did. And now here's the next thing that I need you to do, right? And come back again and again and again. And this can be true for your school board. I am very big on school boards this year. It's been for my opinion, it's been a difficult year for a lot of school boards. City councils. your mayors or state representatives or senates. It's your federal, your House and your Senate and up into the president. And anyone's in a position of leadership. That can include our elected church leadership as well, right? And what we're asking them to do might be different. Think about what power and influence they have and really strategically target your ask around that. It's not just about elected leaders. It's also about reaching your community, your friends, your family, and informing them. If you know something about an issue, you might be the one that teaches and educates everybody else on what that issue is. I know a lot about LGBTQ stuff. I know a lot of news about LGBTQ stuff. And when I go to parties that are not all LGBTQ people, people see and read headlines. Oh, I heard something about transgender women in sports, or I heard this thing that came from Pope Francis yesterday. And I am the person to say, well, here's everything behind that headline you learned. I'm super fun at parties, so please invite me and I'll explain this stuff. And sometimes it means that, most people don't have the time or energy or attention to read and consume everything. I am a gay man who works for an LGBTQ organization, and I cannot follow everything that's out there. I don't expect other people to, but when they do, or if I think it's important, I'll reach out to them and say, hey, this thing is happening. And I can tell them how I think about it. I can't always tell you how you should think about something, but I will absolutely tell you what I'm thinking and what I'm planning. And if I do have an ask, I might ask them to do something. Hey, will you bring this up in your church Bible study or book study or whatever? Will you contact your represented, your elected leaders, because you're in a different state or district or whatever than I am? Will you be able to do this? And give them that ask. We can sometimes give people asks that are really easy to do. When Twitter was still called Twitter, the easiest ask was a retweet, right? Can you just click this button to share out my thing in front of your audiences? There's ways you can do those kind of shares, right, with any kind of social media. And bigger and beyond that is going to be the bigger, harder asks. And the stuff that's harder to do also has more impact. So clicking that share button on social media is a quick, easy dopamine hit, but it's more impactful to make a phone call, to send an email, to make an in-person visit, to bring this up in a conversation. And when you bring something up in front of a group of people, I think sometimes that's scary, especially if you feel like you are the only person that thinks or feels or thinks this is important or thinks this way, especially can we feel this way in our political landscape. When you are in the, when you feel like you're in the political minority culturally, it can be stifling and really hard to speak out. I lived through this a little bit before I worked for GLAAD. I worked for what is now called Reconciling Works. And I was there about the time in 2009 that the ELCA was doing their policy change concerning clergy and deacons and same gender relationships and the human sexuality study. And in the years following that, in which there was a lot of upheaval, there was a lot of people trying to take congregations out of the denomination, stuff like that. I know you, those of you that have been around, probably have heard a lot of stories like that. And I would do a lot of work with people who would have organizing of people trying to take their congregations out of the ELCA. And they realized that they had to, in these congregational meetings, stand up and say, no, I don't agree with that. I think we should stay, or I supported the policy changes that we made. And that's scary if you think you're in the minority. And what happened after people would speak in those meetings is that other people would come up to them in the parking lot or after and kind of whisper and say, I'm really glad you said that. I think that too. And you find other people agree. And it also opens the doors to conversations, which will bring my second Bible study story that I will tell you. Is those kind of conversations are what I've kind of started referring to as Nicodemus moments. Jesus was a big, outspoken person who was saying all the things in front of all the crowds. And the Pharisees were a group that, I'll put it mildly, did not appreciate that, right? And there's probably a lot of among Pharisee crowds and themselves, like saying a lot of terrible, bad things about who Jesus was. Can you believe this person? Why is he talking like this? Why is he always calling us out? All that kind of stuff, right? And it's really hard in front of that group to say, huh, interesting. But Jesus keeps speaking out. And Nicodemus comes to him separate, apart from all of his friends, at nighttime so they can have a private conversation to say, you said some things that really make me wonder, and I want to ask you more questions about it. And then they get to have a conversation that expands on the stuff that Jesus said publicly and has Jesus answering questions, whether they are dumb questions or complicated questions, so that Nicodemus can go about it. And, you know, we don't really know a whole lot about what happens to Nicodemus after that too. Maybe he went, all right, I've edited him out and I'm not really a big fan. Or maybe he kind of became a Jesus supporter in the midst of what was a more hostile crowd. And how he's gone on from there. So you can think of like those kind of conversations really have a really big impact on people's lives. They're hard conversations to have, and yet they are the most impactful and they're the most important. Okay, I have rattled on for at least 20 minutes right now. This is a good pause period because I just threw a bunch of stuff at you and I am very curious if you've got thoughts or questions, reactions to what I said, or if you want to say, Ross, I want to go in a completely different direction. Can we please talk about this? Anyone? And a special shout out to all of you that have your camera on so I can see your lovely faces.
You know, it's interesting to me, when I started working for Bishop Strickland, the number of people who are afraid to reach out to their legislators. Mm-hmm. They don't know what to say. They don't know how to say it. They don't know how do I even find who they are? Which I think is really telling. And I think we need to, so I've tried to give people scripts, say this, or if you really don't want to call, here's an email you can send.
I think, Lucy, you came on camera and started nodding and grunting emphatically. So this is true. This is where most people are, right? And this is the whole, you've got to evaluate yourself. I can't tell you where you are in this world. You know, if you're a really big advocate and you care and you're going all in, do whatever you can to make it easy for everyone else, right? Scripts. It's funny, even in Indivisible, you know, there's a lot of different issues that come up. And sometimes we have guests and we have presentations and, you know, like they kind of give us the case. Oh, we should care about this. We should care about democracy reform or whatever they're talking about. We probably already all agree with them. I was like, I don't need the case. I just need you to tell me what to do. And in fact, one of our group people even said, you don't even have to, we don't need to be a part of the decision-making process. You might just need people to follow orders. And we are a group that like, just tell us what to do and what to say. Scripts are really helpful. Things that make sure people know who their elected leaders are really important. If you're motivated, one thing my husband and I did is we took to writing postcards to elected leaders and we just cut paper and we have pre-printed labels. And I have a sheet from everything from president down to city council member. And that sheet of labels sort of, and we, you know, the issue comes up, a vote or whatever. Okay, it's going to go to these senators. Oh, it's going to go to the representative. Oh, it's going to do this. And we can like combo that out together. But we often do a little bit of like, this is what I want to say, and this is how I want to say it. So yeah, I think that's really important. Lucy, I saw you come off mute too. I'm going to give you a moment.
Yeah. I am one of those who would have never thought I would go and speak to my representative at the state house in Georgia. But I got involved with a group that was called Fair Districts, and that's exactly what they were trying to do. They're very well organized. They called, you know, a date for any of us who were volunteers to come down. They had a meeting beforehand. They explained to us what we were concerned about, what the vote was consideration. And then they gave us notebooks and said, these are some guidelines you can use if you need them. And then they gave us each, you know, whatever it was, 30 or 40 people to go visit. And if they weren't there, to drop something off. And I mean, I'm a pretty outspoken person, but I was not comfortable doing that probably for the first 5 or 10 offices. And then after that, it got easier when I realized there's nobody in that office who knows more about everything than I do. You know, they are just people that have a job and maybe they know about what they're doing, but not really. A lot of times the congressperson was not there and they would, you know, yes, well, we'll pass it on to him. And would you ask him to call us if he has any questions, you know, all of that. It feels a little, perfunctory. But then I had an opportunity on, and I don't remember all the terms, but one of the days where the Congress is meeting, they're getting ready to do a vote, and they have the rope that is outside the main room or whatever. And so my organization said, if you would like to speak to your congressman, you know, you stand along here and you wait in line. That was extremely difficult. And mostly though, because this man was so disrespectful to me and wouldn't even make eye contact with me, wouldn't give me answers to my questions. But what it did, it got me to dig my heels in and ask him more direct things and I told him I'd like to speak to you about it. So, you know, he told me I could go make an appointment with his office. Anyway, I realized he is being unkind, unnecessarily unkind, and he's wrong. I'm right. I'm trying to talk to him civilly about the issue. And like I said, it almost gave me a little more strength to keep working at it. So just for other people who might be afraid.
That is a great story. And I connect with all of those feelings. and I have sometimes called my elected leader and been very happy that it goes to voicemail. Also, I'll say a couple of things. Like when you call, so there's a hierarchy of how much impact it has. And I mentioned this, right? Like tweeting my congressperson or whatever doesn't do a lot. I'll be honest, sign-on petitions online where you add your name to something doesn't really count. It gets counted as one message, no matter how many names are on it. If you call, every individual call gets logged as, it's an office person who is keeping a tally. Are you for or against this vote? Let's say they're just like, Lucy said for, Sigrid said against, and then at the end I'll come to my person and say like, well, here's what the tally was of people. Again, they may vote with you or they may not, depending on what the numbers are. Every individual call, if you do a group thing, it counts as one. Each time you call, if you call once every day, that's one every single day. And of course a visit then of course is more, it's more difficult to do, but it can have a bit further of impact. We are very much politically, we're in a very divided time. And you're right. There's a great level of disrespect. And I know that there are some folks that like think that being mean is the point, which makes the things we're talking about even harder to do. And I'm seeing the note here from Catherine, right? Someone who's very excited to talk about how they want to be involved with gun violence or how they want to use that as a tool of intimidation. It's a tool of intimidation. And so there's, you know, what are the other ways in which we can get to a person and make sure that they see and hear that. And if it's not your, and so then you think about, okay, we've had to do this in New York. And I know people like hear New York and you think like, oh, it's this deep blue progressive state. However, this is politics here is weird and complicated and secret. And there's a lot of gross stuff that goes on here. So please know every state you look at that you say like, well, it's either like deep, deep red or deep, deep blue. There's a lot of other things that are usually going on in those particular states too, that sometimes can break that stereotype. But we in New York, you know, two-party system, there was a group of, I'm going to get a little bit partisan here, but there was a group of Democrats that would call themselves the Independent Democratic Caucus. The Democrats actually held a majority in the Senate, but because of those eight senators always voting with Republicans meant that they held the majority, but nothing ever got passed. And Indivisible New York said, this is an impediment to what we want to get done. And so if we're going to do it, we have to replace these eight people. And they decided for the next year, like that was going to be that was their 2018 goal, right? Mm-hmm. Like, let's get these eight people out and get them replaced with someone that is at least more open. And I'll be honest, replacing those eight did not immediately solve the problem. They said, oh, here's the next thing we need to do. Here, it sometimes involved the governor. And we got to get him replaced too, right? And so doing things like, if we want to get this done, and this is why elections are important, I will say too, is trying to get people that are, I'm going to put it this way, the most likely to help advance the work that we're trying to do. And sometimes that is, can I pull back from the person that's trying to, you know, actively work in opposition to me? Who's going to be the most reasonable choice? And I have to remind people, the election, winning an election is not the actual goal. The goal is getting the policy or the action or the thing done. If the election is really just trying to get the people that are most likely to do that in the right place. And so, you know, as much as GLAAD and my organization is pushing voting, and I am in the middle of that for us, and this is a big election year, I always remind people, like, it is not over in November. When we get to a choice, when we get to November, we have to look at all the candidates. We have to see everyone from the president's race down to the school board and the dog catcher kind of positions and start to figure out who are going to be the people that are least likely to cause harm or the most likely to be able to be helpful. And sometimes most likely might not go as far as you want them to go, which I'm sure you've heard a lot of criticisms like that of candidates or of elected leaders. And when we're kind of, especially in the way our system's set up, and we're kind of given for the most part a binary choice with a couple other choices that always get called spoilers, it's not a good system, but it's the one we're in. We have to, my other phrase I use a lot, be wise as serpents and innocent as doves, to sort of be like, I'm going to make the next best choice I can do. And it doesn't stop with that. There'll be more that comes after that. And there'll be more that comes after that. And there'll be more that comes after that. But Lucy, I think what you experience is, I think a lot of people feel it. I know I absolutely do. And I think that can be incredibly helpful. Other thoughts or questions?
Ross, I appreciated your using the story of Nicodemus as one of your stories. And it's a reminder to me that Jesus would sit down at the table with everyone. Jesus would want to connect with everyone. And of course, most of the stories in the Gospels are of him talking with people who are really marginalized. But, you know, he went and had lunch with Simon the Pharisee. He was receptive to Nicodemus. So he really welcomed everybody at the table, but then really dealt with the issues there. He got people talking to each other about what the issues were. So the Nicodemus story is very, very provocative in that way.
The reason I like Nicodemus, it's so odd. Now that I work at GLAAD, this sounds like bragging, but it's not. The number of clandestine meetings that we have with people is kind of amazing. And we have been, I was not in this meeting, but some folks that I work with were several years ago. Do you all remember Glenn Beck? Had a meeting with him, right? And like, who set this up and what's going to happen? And it's that Nicodemus type meeting, right? Like, we're not going to acknowledge this happened. We're not going to share. We're not going to talk about it, but we're going to have a conversation. And then we're probably going to have this like closed door conversation. And then we're going to go out and we're going to be public personas that may or may not match who we were in that closed door conversation, and recognize that piece too. There's a kind of newly elected, I think he's from South Carolina. He's in the US House and in the last 2 years, and he's been doing really good sort of like TikTok videos of sort of like, this is what being in the US House has been like. And one of the stories he told was, and he was trying to not name names, but he said, I was in a closed door meeting with someone who's really known as being confrontational and mean and that like public persona. He said, and this person has a completely different and much nicer personality when there are not cameras around, when there's not an audience, when there's not other people. that can also sometimes be really helpful too, to get people into that Nicodemus conversation, because it will take you away from that public persona too, which I think can be really helpful. Catherine, I saw you come off mute.
Yeah. I liked one of the things that I highlighted that was, you know, such an easy idea. Like if you can just take 10 or 20 minutes, was entering each of your elected leaders' contact info into your contacts, right? Like their phone, their email, and even that other number that isn't widely available. It was such a great idea, because I think every time, you know, the legislative session comes and they're making votes and everything, everybody's like, who is my leader? Mm-hmm. How do I get in touch with them? What's, you know, and right now, you know, all that's kind of passed. But if I take some time, or especially, you know, after the election, and put those people in, then when I need it, I'm just going through my contacts like anybody else. And I'm saying, you know, I could just title it my congressman, my senator.
Yep.
And you know, make those calls and reach out so much easier.
Yeah.
So I encourage people to do that.
Yeah, it's a good early to mid November exercise to be like, time to update my elected leader contacts. And again, that's like pre-printing out those address labels. Or, and if you've got, for your senators, right, they have multiple offices, right? Someone put Marsha Blackburn, so I'll reference her in here too. Like, I don't know how many, but she's probably got 4 or more offices in the state, right? Spread around. And then she's got her DC office as well. And sometimes when we call, everyone thinks to call the DC office. I'll be honest, because I don't get a full voicemail, I will sometimes call the Buffalo, New York office of Senator Chuck Schumer, because I know that's the one that might be the most likely to not be full, to be the least crowded, to be the DC one gets all the attention. And if you are hitting dead ends with the other one, you can kind of do these, like, let's call other places. Because again, it's a staffer that is tallying folks. And again, you always tell them you're a constituent, right? Like, I'm a constituent. I live in, sometimes they want your like exact address. Sometimes, you know, you're gonna get your like emails or letters back, where they acknowledge that they heard from you, you know, but I make sure they know that they're not hearing from people out of state, which is why I also rarely call elected leaders from other states. Indivisible taught me this, unless you're a donor, because money certainly talks. These elected leaders might not care what you think if you're not a constituent or not a donor. And so that's the place where you sort of have the in as much as possible. Even, again, I will say this, even if you're an elected leader that perhaps feels very oppositional to you too, you're still a constituent. So I would still say those are definitely worth ones to make. And I will say this to you, if your elected leader is in agreement with you and thinks and does and says all the right things, still call them. They need that encouragement, because they're absolutely hearing it from somebody else from the other side. Let them know that you know, I've heard you're going to vote yes for this thing that I support. Thank you. That's going to be really important. I want you to know that your constituents support you in that, because it is easier to call when we're angry and don't want them to do something. Sometimes a little bit harder to call them to tell them, like, thank you for what you did do, or stay strong in the face of opposition.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting to me too. I think people have forgotten how to have conversations with people who disagree with you, mm-hmm. right? You have to choose one of the extremes. There can be no meeting in the middle. And I watched last week, it was a conversation, I think it was at the National Cathedral, between the Republican governor of Utah and the Democratic governor of Maryland.
Mm.
And it was a fascinating conversation, because the governor of Utah was basically saying, we need to be in the same room together. That's the only way we're going to get things done. And we need to understand how to have a conversation with each other. And we can meet in the middle. Mm-hmm. And it was interesting, because Utah has a very low child poverty rate. And the governor of Maryland is instituting some of the same practices that they do in Utah, because he wants to lower the child poverty rate. It was really, really interesting. And, you know, I know their personas, but they seemed like pretty genuine people. It was a really great conversation. And it was a little bit encouraging that there are people that recognize that this is the problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think there's a couple of things I think, like and I'll say this too, being in conversations like that actually makes you better and smarter about your own position too, because I think the more nuanced we can talk about things, the better. And I realize it can be very dismissive to say something like it's complex, which, you know, can be a dismissive sort of statement. And I do think recognizing and really thinking through, here's what's important, here's what's helpful, here's the best scenario of what I possibly could think could ever happen. When I did an MBA program, and one of our final papers, the teacher kept like, wife, like, I don't know, it was a very vocation kind of thing. If you know Lily Grant's vocation stuff, it was very much like, you know, what's your vocation in the world of all things possible, right? So we're supposed to be like dreaming gigantic and big. We should always be articulating that world. We believe in and worship a God that goes farther beyond any of our understanding or expectations. And that gigantic, cosmic, super intimate, like God that we work with, means that we can really dream and speak into, this is the way that I see the world being. And because we live in a broken, sinful world, we also say, here's the steps that can get us there. Knowing, again, this goes back to whatever we do will probably fall short in some way or another. And so we say, here's how I can get there. Here's how I can achieve that. Here's how this compromise isn't the end of that task, but perhaps is the step that can get me towards something fuller. How I can add that yes and on top of it. And to also say, you know, I want this really great thing. We always got to think about this. Here's the way that that really great thing might be weaponized or might be problematic for someone else, right? I'm a gay, white, cisgender man. I can only see and understand and experience the world through the lens with which I have. And the things that make me feel safe, welcome, comfortable in the world is not necessarily the same thing that makes somebody else feel safe and comfortable and welcome in the world too. And so there is that thinking of that like universal design model, like what's the way that does make all actually mean all? And that's trickier. And that only comes through those kind of conversations, debates. At work, we call it tension testing. Like, let's try to poke as many holes in this as possible and see where and how this could go wrong. And then when we know that, we can make informed choices about what we're going to do with that. Other thoughts? I will... I think, Allison, you sent a blur, an excerpt from the book, right?
Did I send an excerpt from the book?
Yeah, I can't remember if we talked about it.
I don't think I did.
Okay. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to like read you a chunk of the last chapter, because I realize I usually, when people ask me to read excerpts of the book, I do two things. I either read the first chapter, which was fun, was really fun to write. It started with a speech. It was given an honor at Warburg Seminary and had to do a little speech with that too. And I know it's terrible. I know I was given the honor because that was the 50th anniversary of the Stonewall riots. And so like everybody was doing gay stuff then. So like, let's give an award to the gay guy. But I took that sort of as a moment of, you know, Stonewall was a moment in history. And again, it was formative and instructive for the work that I do. If you ever come to New York, Stonewall is still a real functioning bar. Around the corner is Julius's, which is an even older and also historic functioning gay bar in an area. And they're both lovely. And realizing that like when you're gay, sometimes you don't learn this history until you grow up, come out, understand a little bit more who you are, and then kind of understand this longer stream of history that you're a part of. And realizing that that movement, you know, didn't necessarily start at Stonewall. It started with the generation before that, and the generation before that, and the generation before that. And you keep doing this history until essentially you get back to the creation of the world. And that this movement that we're a part of has always been there. And we are alive for a brief period of time that gets to pick that movement up from the people before us and pass it off to the next generation. And I am currently of the age where I feel like I'm actively in the midst of doing that, passing on to the next generation. And realizing that people are going to take the words, the work, and the action that I've done and probably do things that I never imagined were possible with it too. That's how the book kind of starts. It ends with my laundry list of this is the everyday advocate stuff, because we've been talking about elected leaders and elections and I will say other gifts that people can use, writing op-eds. That is, if you're a writer, those are really helpful. And then as we get into this living your advocacy on a daily basis, this really is about what are the choices that we make every single day that will help us to make this world a better place. And I don't know if you all were a fan of the television show, The Good Place, but there is a great episode that really speaks about every choice and everything we do has repercussions. And sometimes it's hard, you know, we're in a broken, sinful world. We cannot make an action without there being some kind of negative consequence with it too. The show has demonstrated that, in a humorous way. And we also have to figure out that there are things that we're going to have to be able to do. And so we think about how to make this the lifestyle that we take. It's not an add-on. It's not something else that we do to our day. It informs all the choices that we make. So I'm going to read the little intro and I'm going to read my list. Remember how at the beginning of the book, I said I never intended to be an activist? To be honest, I still feel like I'm figuring it all out. Our world is broken and sinful in so many ways, and there are so many people and organizations trying to solve our problems. I continue to be in awe of those activists who are making real world impact through their actions. My focus has been on the intersection between LGBTQ advocacy and faith, but that is only one area of focus. The interconnections of the LGBTQ community overlap with every other aspect of our human life on Earth. This means I need to care about everything else. At a minimum, I need to avoid inadvertently harming partner movements by my actions. As I grow and become more aware of the complexity of the issues around us, I am learning that I cannot think of advocacy as something that I add to the demands in my daily routine. Rather, I must think of it as something that I live out through every aspect of my daily life. It becomes naturally ingrained into every decision I make, every action I take, every relationship I form. Our values are reflected in every choice we make. They show up in our purchases, our messages, and our interactions. In short, it becomes a lifestyle. And I will confess, I'm using I and me language a lot here, so that it's confessional, and I can talk about myself as opposed to being preachy and telling you all what you need to think and do, but hoping that's an example. We live in a world of systemic sin. We participate in racism, sexism, exploitation, xenophobia, homophobia, transphobia, ableism, and so many other sins without even realizing what we're doing. It will take constant self-examination to learn how we can disrupt those systems in our own lives and the communities and cultures in which we participate. We also know that we are human, born in sin, and cannot fully justify ourselves. Our actions and advocacy are not about justifying ourselves. Rather, they're about using the grace God has given us to allow everyone to live freely. After the 2016 election, so many of us were in despair without a really clear direction of what to do. It seemed like everything we've been working for was about to be dashed. The progress we had built seemed in peril. Environmentalists worried about government changing regulations to make it easier to exploit the earth. Women worried about their freedoms and futures. Immigrants, people of color, LGBTQ people, and other marginalized groups instantly felt a target on their backs. I needed to put what had changed with the election into perspective and focus on what I could control. I started writing a document that looked at both immediate and long-term needs. One thing that struck me as I put the document together was the actions I was proposing weren't very different from what I would have recommended before the election. It was just that the context had shifted and made those actions more urgent. This final chapter takes those suggestions as a template for how we might live out our values in the everyday choices we make. I'm going to read the list here from here. Focus on where your money goes. The first place to examine is where and how you spend your money. In a capitalist economy like we have in the United States, money signifies priorities. The money we give to a business indicates how much of a necessity the item is or how much we value it. And so there's ways to examine where and how you spend your money, where and how you bank with your money, how we use our money in order to help or to harm the earth. There's a lot of stuff on money here. Consume good information. We also need to talk about consuming good information and fighting disinformation. I spend a lot of time talking about our worldviews. Worldviews are not easily changed, but constant reinforcement can shift or harden them. Since the 2016 election, we've had a lot of conversation about what gets called fake news and the role that social media has in spreading misinformation. We've been exposed to constant misinformation about the coronavirus, the 2020 election, the curriculum being taught in schools, crime and policing, the economic impact of the wealthy versus the working class, and so much more just within the last past couple of years. Of course, propaganda isn't new, but social media adds a new dimension. It allows anyone to become a propagandist, sometimes even inadvertently. And then I say strengthen democracy through civic engagement. Finally, we need to participate in democracy constantly. In the United States, it feels like we're in a never-ending election cycle. The media often focuses on the horse race of the side of the news, talking about it as a fight between two political parties. You can transcend this perspective by remembering your worldview and the goals of your advocacy. We elect people not so that a political party can have power, but so that we can advance our values in real, tangible ways. We want political leaders who will help enact helpful laws and policies, or at a minimum, defend against laws and policies that will move our cause backwards. This is not about political parties, but about values. Participation in democracy means voting in every single election. Primary elections are when we can most easily vote in alignment with our values, since we have a wider range of choices. The general election often has fewer options and may involve voting with the candidate on the ballot who is the most likely to advance our values. Runoff and special elections have just as much impact and are often determined by a handful of votes, but the results have a tremendous impact on our lives. The more local the election, the more direct the impact. You can and should strategically get involved with political campaigns for candidates who align with your values and seem the most likely to act upon them. They will be the ones who may help advance your advocacy and drive real-world impact. You can also support democracy by supporting nonpartisan voter registration drives and encouragement for every eligible citizen to vote. You can do this as a church. We can do this as nonprofit 501c3s. We do not get in trouble for registering voters and encouraging people to vote. This is my whole aside. People come up with that, but it's political. It's not. It breaks laws if I tell you who to vote for. And of course, I have opinions on who you should vote for, and you probably do too. But just encouraging people to vote in general is something that we can do as nonprofit organizations. In between elections, we should continue to be in touch with our elected leaders. If they agree with you, thank them and encourage them to be bold leaders who bring their peers along. If they're on the fence, let them know why you think they should take action that supports your position. If they're in opposition, let them know that they are out of step with their constituency. Remind them that another election is always coming, and you are looking for an elected leader who will make this a better, more just, and equitable world. And I have to end by being clear. None of these things by themselves solve the brokenness of the world. As I said, the problems we face are legion, and the responses to help people cope with the inequity as well as make things better will take a multiplicity of perspectives, utilizing a variety of actions. And of course, new problems will arise. There really is no short-term fix. That's where our advantage as Christians come in. We are taught stories about God's relationship with a broken and sinful humanity that spans millennia. We see the advancements and setbacks documented in the Bible that often mirror our own world. While the particular issues confronted in the Bible may not totally match what we are facing today, we can see the same types of emotions and responses spelled out. That gives us a vision for our own attitudes and how we can try to match God's long-term vision for the world God created. All the things I mentioned in this chapter are lifestyle changes. They're to be incorporated into our daily routine, changing the way we interact with the world around us. Even our small actions can have ripple effects. We sometimes assume that changing the world for the better involves extraordinary action, but there is no magic solution to the troubles the world is facing. It will require constant, prayerful examination of our actions, our choices, and our budgets. And occasionally, just occasionally, God will call us to an extraordinary task. It will be something that we never imagined for ourselves, but the Holy Spirit will give us strength and guidance to continue imperfectly. And the grace of God will carry us through. And when we are done running this race, we will be greeted with, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That is my prayer. Amen. I am happy to stick around and chit chat further. I don't remember if we were going for an hour or 90 minutes, but I can adjust to either.
Either one is fine with me. My favorite chapter was the one on using scripture.
That was fun.
I did. I love that chapter.
I can't remember what this, is the thing. I have so many thoughts in my head. I can't remember what I wrote down, what I haven't written down either. One of the things I've seen that pops up lately is people will say like, well, that's not biblical. The list of things that we do now that are not Zoom is not biblical. The United States of America is not biblical. Your 401k is not biblical, right? Republicans and Democrats are not biblical. This is what, like, we are in a world that is not the same that is being described in the Bible. And yet we see these same themes keep showing up over and over and over again. And occasionally we find stuff that is, with the podcast that I do, we mentioned this, I'll put some of my links here before we leave, but the podcast that I do, we'll do a Bible story. And I'm like the producer, I write scripts, and then there's comedians that talk about this. And they will, I like to lean into the weird Bible stories because they're fun and there's a lot of them. And for a long time, whenever I would do these Bible stories and we would just read through the scripture and, you know, I'd be writing jokes, not even commentary, just jokes based on what they were saying. One of the hosts, the comedian, would yell, "How come nobody's ever told me about this?" We skip a lot of the Bible. This is the most controversial. In Numbers, this might get me kicked off the Zoom, but in Numbers, there are directions on a certain drink that a woman can take to induce an abortion. There's a directive on how to do it in the Bible. And again, abortion is it becomes a very big political thing. It's very personal for folks. It's been definitely a political driver for the last years. And people line up on that, often using scriptural arguments. And realizing that this is actually referenced, not with judgment, but as a, hey, do this kind of thing, is one of those odd things. And you know, you get that with LGBTQ stuff, you get that with migrants, you get that with outsiders, you get that with economic justice, you get that with taxes, you get that with so many things that we talk about today. And we, every so often we get these scriptures like, oh, they actually, like the same thing that we're talking about today shows up there. But we don't often talk about the way that it showed up in those stories. And that's where those like nuanced conversations can really have fun. And again, I say fun because that is one, that abortion prescription, I think, is one verse that's pulled out of Numbers somewhere. So there's always the proof texting thing of like, well, don't just do that. So read the chapter before and the chapter after, please. I would never tell anyone to pull one verse of scripture out. And
right.
I will put a couple links in the chat here too. I also say this too, since we're being hosted by the Synod and we're represented from a different Synod here too. There are resources to help you do this. So I obviously do a bunch of stuff. I'm putting like GLAAD, the naming project. And of course my computer's not participating with me. Of course the ELCA has an advocacy office. And we have a director who's based in DC. They take campaigns. They've got good signage. They've got the scripts. They've got, you can get sign. My husband like took all their signs from the youth ministry extravaganza because he really liked them. They've got talking guides and discussion guides and all those things that are really helpful.
Yes. And Amy Ruman will be at Synod Assembly.
Oh, that's right. Yes, she will. And I mean, and Allison is your gateway to who the other groups are. When we were planning for this, you know, I asked, are there those like, there are statewide faith-based groups. When I lived in Minnesota, that one was called Isaiah. Can you help me, Allison, what's the Georgia one and the Tennessee one that you emailed to me?
The Georgia one is Georgia Interfaith Public Policy Council.
Okay.
And then the Tennessee one that we do a lot of work with is Southern Christian Coalition.
Okay.
In Washington State, we have Faith Action Network, FAN, Faith Action Network.
Right. And sometimes the like state council of churches has filled that role in some states too, depending. I know in New York, that economic justice thing that we've done has been worked with the New York Council of Churches. And my other promotion that I should absolutely say, sorry, you're getting me like pulling stuff in real time. Part of my job is to train people on how to engage with the media. It's LGBTQ, but again, the skills we talk about can be used by anyone. And the timing was not great because we were in Nashville in February, but we are doing a two-day training in Atlanta, April 26th and 27th. So this is, sorry, it's an ugly URL.
I've already signed up if anybody wants to join me.
Yeah, we would love to have you there. Normally our days are, our trainings are one day. There's some staff, someone who reports to me is based in Atlanta and he's trying to make this into a bigger thing. So it's going to be 2 days, one day worth of training. Some work with, Representative Park Cannon is going to be one of our speakers. She is a GLAAD Media Institute alum that came to one of our earlier trainings. Very excited about that. Local city council leader, the head of the LGBTQ Chamber of Commerce, or maybe I think Latina Chamber of Commerce will be there. And there's kind of three tracks. There's kind of a general media advocacy training. There'll be a Spanish language, bilingual Spanish language training, and one that's called Compass, which is focused on HIV work. GLAAD has a lot of work with HIV organizations, including some stuff that's happening out of Emory and out of, I think, Vanderbilt, and out of Alabama. In all the states that the Synod is in, because it's very Southern focused. And so if any of you want to join and be there with us, we would absolutely love to have you. And I am going to be at that with my team. And in addition to kind of the trainings, we give people interview practice, teach you how to answer questions so that you can be on message and on point. And we'll ask you some good questions. We'll ask you some problematic hard ones to make you weasel your way back into what you want to talk about. And we're also going to set up, I'm not calling it a selfie station. I don't figure what we're going to call it. Very big into pro voting. And I want people to share messages to encourage you to vote. So there will be a little station of like, put your camera, put your phone in this tripod, help us work on a script of what you want to say. And then you can be the one that looks in the camera and says, this election is going to be incredibly important. You need to vote in every office. Here's the date of the election. Here's what you do. To Catherine's question, it is free. There's a happy hour sponsored by Hornitos after the first night. So no under 21 at the happy hour, but we did get okay if they can come to the training. It is absolutely free. We just want people to be engaged and informed and hoping that you will continue to do this work after the training. And I will say this from me from GLAAD, I treat you like alumni, which means I get to be very excited and proud and amplify any work that you do. And we will encourage you and try to give you other opportunities that you can plug into to advocacy work. And GLAAD has staff. We have at least three or four people that are based in Atlanta now. And so you can engage with them and also do a lot of follow-up, which is great. I would love to have you there. I put the naming project in there. And I'm going to also mention the podcast. So I will give you one of those. It's called Yes, Jesus. It is very irreverent. Let me also say it's the adult humor that as an adult professional, the things that I don't say professionally, I can put in a script and make a comedian say, and then it's okay. So just know, adulty humor. And yet, incredibly faithful.
Any other questions, thoughts?
I do have a question. Deacon Ross, this is Carol Johnson.
Carol?
I'm in the North Carolina Synod currently and from the Metro Chicago Synod. There are some, because of some of the activity that's been going on politically, there have been some worship spaces that have kind of toyed in the humor area of advocacy when it comes to trans. And some of that's done in public worship, and it seems to be met with different kinds of reaction. So I know your specialty is really, you know, as a deacon, the engaging the world in the church, but also the church sometimes fumbles about how we do things in communicating with the world in ways that can be inviting and welcoming and not offensive. So I just wondered if you have any comments about that that might be fruitful for ministers in preparation.
Yeah, that's a really good question. Probably a little loaded too. I'm gonna take it into a couple different approaches. One, I will say, humor with transgender people is often very tricky if you're not transgender yourself. For so long, transgender people have been the butt of the joke. And if you've never seen it, there's an excellent film, it's on Netflix, called Disclosure, Trans Lives on Screen, that documents that very well, how that's shown up in film and in television. One of my coworkers are a producer on it, another coworker appears on screen as one of the interviewees, everybody's on there is trans. And so jokes about trans people can often like inadvertently even make people the butt of the joke. And I have colleagues that are actually working on like transgender humor themselves. And then kind of, you know, what you said, I thought you were going to go in a slightly different direction. So there is also, yeah, how the church engages in the wider world. And I am really big, you know, I think my thoughts on the Lutheran Church and the ELCA are often, we don't often go big in engaging in the bigger, wider world. It's sometimes often easier to say, okay, how are people thinking and feeling? How do we keep our church going, keep alive? I know after the 2009 decision policy change, everyone's very fearful of what they, you know, what was going to be lost or what could be lost and what could happen. And I think making really smart, strategic, bold statements in the community can be really powerful and impactful and helpful. And often those voices are not coming from Christian churches. And often we often don't want to sound like those kind of Christians. And then we say nothing at all, which means we don't get anything. And people just assume that we hold the same positions as, say, an anti-LGBTQ Christian does because we're not really vocally saying otherwise. So I would also say anything you do or want to say, have it be informed by the community that's the most impacted, right? If you want to speak about LGBTQ people or trans people, spend some time listening and learning, even saying like, what can we do or say that's going to be most helpful? Maybe they don't want you to say anything. Maybe they'd rather just like, let us use your space for something. I think that's often true for a lot of marginalized groups. Like, hi, we have this space, we have a few hundred people, whatever it is, and we care about this and we want to be helpful. What is the thing that we can do? And maybe it won't be nothing now, but at least they know that you've built and done that relationship, which also means if you do or say something in the future, it could be much better informed, have that backup. Where I thought you were going, your question was also in our hyper-politicized and perhaps violent world. I have also been working with some congregations that sometimes have done or said some stuff, been those bold witnesses, and then get harassment, threats of violence, stuff like that. Last year, it was Holy Week. It was Monday, Thursday, and I was one messaging with a pastor who was transgender, but also did a sermon where they spoke about the gun violence that happened in Nashville the year before, or at that time, I guess. And it got picked up by some media that splashed it out and put it out there. And of course, so then my immediate concern was like, what are you gonna do for your own like safety? And who do you have that's helping and backing you up on this too, to make sure you've got some help there too. At the same time, another GLAAD Media Institute alum. If you're familiar with the book Queerfully and Wonderfully Made, the author of that, Lee Finke, is now a Minnesota state representative, first transgender representative in Minnesota, and has been through GLAAD Media Institute trainings. I contributed to that book. I really love all the stuff that Lee does. But at the same time, Lee texted me, said, well, they found the book. And so people made that into a thing, which has now turned Lee into a target. And Lee's now a public figure, which means she will be a target. Obviously, this pastor in this church, we're not anticipating that, but I'm also hearing a lot of that from people too. So I hate saying this, but you also have to have sort of like a safety plan and a risk management plan with that as well. Some churches are doing things like drag worship, which I think can be a great idea. It can be a great involvement with the community, get in partnership with the community. Drag is one of those things that has gotten targeted in a really kind of gross way. And I'm not saying not to do it. In fact, I think it's important that we do that, and that we make it a part, that we incorporate that into the way that we do worship, because the artistry that drag artists will bring to this will be beautiful. And I know there's a suburban Atlanta church that did one of those last, also got a lot of pushback on that too. And so how to do that in a really good way, and then say, how do we make sure that we don't back down when we know inevitably there's going to be a response? We think it's important for us to do this, and we should anticipate a negative reaction, and we should anticipate this is how we're going to respond to that negative reaction. I've had to do that over this last year with corporations concerning pride. I've had to do that with our own denomination, who, you know, when people see a lot of really politicized stuff and sees violent backlash, they say, well, maybe it's better not to do or not to say something. A little bit of a argument right now about the incorporation of drag into some elements too. So if anyone wants to work with me on that, we'll have an off the record conversation about all that stuff. And figuring out what's going to be the best, you know, how do we do that in a way that's going to be good and faithful, matches our values, matches our beliefs, who we are as a church, and knowing and trusting that people are going to handle and do that well. And someone's still going to get angry about it. For the naming project, I do as much background check, adult screening, careful supervision. And last year we also got listed on websites that drove a lot of hate mail and death threats to us too. So I don't want to mitigate the harm that exists in the world, but I don't want that risk to stop us from doing the thing in the first place. And I get really flippant about this. Once again, we follow Jesus, who also said a lot of things and angered a lot of people. And he was arrested and executed. And so I'm not, this is my challenge that I have of like, we can't just not do things because there might be harm and violence, because harm and violence is actually a part of our resurrection story. And we have to think about that resurrection story too. I'm a youth ministry person. I think a lot about risk, and how to mitigate it, how to prevent it. And when something bad does happen, what things are important enough that we're going to take the risk to do it in the first place? And that is a lot of like thought process that, you know, we have to do before we do any of the big actions.
Thank you.
I took your question and went in like four different directions.
No, it's fine. And I love that, because we take learnings also. So even as we take those risks, we learn and make more informed decisions that further what we're trying to do. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. Others? Other questions, comments?
I have a question. This is Ann Stevens. There's been a couple times when in my own congregation, I've brought up LGBTQ advocacy things and been told, no, we can't, that's political. And it's only political because one party's made it political. To me, it's a human rights issue. But how do I, in my own ELCA church, respond to that? How should I tell them that, no, it's human right? You know, do you have any better ways to say it? Or how do I deal with that?
Yeah, good. Hey, yeah, go ahead, Catherine.
Catherine, I just wanted to share something along those lines that I made a note of, you know, with the church, my church being my target for some advocacy. I kind of stole from what you talked about in your book and how you convinced your grandmother how important it was to vote for something that she didn't feel related to her. And I said, you know, within my church, I could say, yeah, you know, we know the majority of our church is straight, but you might have a colleague or maybe you have a niece or a child who is gay. And wouldn't you be proud if they felt welcome in your church? Wouldn't you be proud if this place shifted the narrative they grew up with and could reaffirm their relationship with Christ?
That's great. Actually, and that it's kind of the direction, kind of the answer I was going to give. You know, things are only political when we make them political. And if we're a church, our starting point is values. I use values language a lot. And to think and talk about what values. So like, you know, values are things like, I want people to be able to be safe and healthy, to be able to grow up into, for LGBTQ youth, I want them to grow up and to be healthy, productive members of society. I believe and I value in the inherent dignity and worth of God's creation, and not having that creation being limited, boxed off, cut short. And we talk about it as a value. When it's political, it's going to be when people say political, well, people use political as a silencing technique, that kind of word. And there is a big difference between political and partisan. And here's what's important. My values are my values, no matter what my political affiliation is. In fact, I probably have a political affiliation that is more shaped by my values than trying to form my values around, say, like a political identity. And so if you want to start kind of at that high level, like, let's talk about what welcome and inclusion in the congregation looks like, what safety in our community looks like, mm-hmm. what making sure that, and using LGBTQ as an example, you know, what are the resources that exist here for our young people? What are the dangers that exist for our young people here? And what can we as a congregation do to try to fix that, to change that? If we know that there's, you know, if bullying happens and is rampant, then how do we find a way that we stop that, prevent that? Both, and I will say this too, this is actually, here's my other piece I will say about political. I wish we didn't have to pass laws to tell people to do the right thing.
Yeah.
And we didn't have to force them into not murdering or not bullying or, you know, or not stealing. And yet we live in a broken, sinful world, and we do have to pass laws that actually like says, no, don't do this. And if you do, there has to be some level of punishment, right? And I know someone can do a whole first, second, third, fourth use of the law sort of breakdown of that, of what that can look like today in Lutheran theology. You know, this is, I want people to do the right thing regardless of their political affiliation. And political, you know, to me kind of means, I think that becomes a silent thing to say like, well, let's just talk about how we can fix and solve the problem. Right? It's not the person, it's not the party, it's the problem that we're trying to fix. And if someone's being a bully, if they're a peer and a fellow student, like what are the ways that we can help stop, prevent that, redirect that bullying energy? If that bully is an adult, teacher, community member, elected leader, what are the things that we can do to prevent that from happening? This is one of the, I'm glad I have a weird job, but I also got sent to Tulsa, Oklahoma in the wake of the death of a student named Nex Benedict, who was bullied, got into a fight in the bathroom, died the next day, kind of learned, this is in the state of Oklahoma, learned that bullying was rampant in the school, and there's a lot of policies and political leaders that want to keep it that way. I'll support it that way. And there's ways that we can and should be able to solve the problem. One of those solutions is going to be political, but other parts are going to be cultural, emotional, religious, theological. And we can think about how we approach things like that.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Sure. You're all doing great for a Tuesday night.
Right. I think our time is just about up. Mary Jo, were you going to say something? You're muted.
Okay, I will say something. Our church just became an RIC church. It took about 5 years, probably would have been a little less if it hadn't been COVID. And so we're being very conscious of the fact, and it was about 82% were for and the other folks weren't. And we're being very conscious of the fact of not alienating anyone and because people were going, oh, now the gays will take over the church. You know, it's like, was that? And so I'm just curious what you see the benefits of being an RIC church is, except, I mean, we went through the process of being more educated and having people not just say, well, we always welcomed everyone anyway. What's the big deal? You know, that was the whole big thing. So anyway, I'm just curious what you say about that.
Sure. Well, as someone who used to run the RIC program for that organization, I have that some churches have my signature on their certificate that they got for their RIC thing, because I was doing that for a while and then running these. So I'm glad you did the process, and I'm glad you really worked the process, because part of that really is building up congregational identity, relationships. How are we going to talk about issues? How are we going to, and again, those are good skills that go beyond this too. I think you're right. People, a lot of, again, we operate out of fear a lot. And there's a lot of fear of like, what's gonna happen if we do this? What's going to happen if we do this? And the fear of the gays taking over, I can give you like really heartfelt answers. I give you super flip answers. Like, you should be so lucky. We will make that church the best place that everyone in town is going to want to go to, right? If we're actually given whole free reign, we are known as neighborhood gentrifiers, right? So that's my flippant answer. The things that RIC does, I mentioned before, the assumption that Christianity is inherently anti-LGBTQ is strong. And I've been saying this a lot to people now, the reputation of Christianity is not great. And we are now at a place that people don't feel forced or compelled to join or have to be with. This is why you see attendance going down. You see people sort of like drifting away. And we haven't done a ton besides just complain like that they've gone somewhere else. And I think if we adjust our attitude to people don't inherently trust us, it will make us behave and act in a different way. It will make us do the things that work to earn people's trust, rather than just assume that we already have it, which for most of Christendom, we kind of have been able to assume that we have it from most people. And so, you know, we've got 1500 or more years of unlearning of that. RIC is one of those ways in which of doing that. It is a way of specifically putting on our list that says, we have thought about this and gone through a process and had discussion at a point where we can figure out how to be welcoming and how to be inclusive. It is still a thing that we will work on and that we will practice, but it also means when someone goes to town and they're saying, and I get this too, Ross, can you recommend a church that I can go visit? I get this from non-Lutherans. I go to that RIC list because I'm biased. I want to send them all to Lutheran churches. And I will tell them these are the ones to think to go to, because they're asking that sort of recommendation from somebody within the community, right? And I use that list as my referral place, this is a place that I'm going to make some assumptions that you are less likely to have a negative experience when you walk through that door. RIC also opens the door about how to continue to have conversations about more. I mean, when I worked at Reconciling Works, we actually were apologetic. You don't have to do marriages. You don't have to ordain LGBTQ people. Those are gone. They have, you know, those are things you have to do. You have to make an anti-racist commitment. I think there's at least one other thing you have to do. So like they have added requirements, right? Of like, this means that you're not just thinking about this as like this narrow issue, but you're actually thinking about it more holistically than we were the 15 years ago that I worked there. And so that makes the congregation more resilient and stronger, especially if you do the process well. And one of the steps in the process, I remember from training this is, take a straw poll of the congregation. If the straw poll is not an 80% pass, do not try to bring that vote forward and keep doing the like work, because it's going to take more time and maybe it will take 5 years, which is fine. As someone who was a member of a congregation, a 2,500 member congregation where RIC lost by 11 votes, that is deeply painful, right? And very difficult. And people said, we can't ever revisit this. We need to bury it underground and go away. And that same kind of division kind of steps kept seeping. So there is the church reputation piece. There is the internal congregational strength and resiliency piece, I think, that's really important. And it is a really good referral point for other people that just want a short end of like, I need to know where to be safe and I can't figure it out, because other churches, and they've figured this out, have learned that they can do or say some like pseudo welcoming things. Noah's Ark has a good rainbow in the story, which means any church could put a rainbow up. Maybe not that like six color flag that we use a lot. People can say or sing all are welcome. When I was in Minneapolis, there was a Baptist church that was very close to where the Pride parade ended and the park kind of happened. And they were hosting events in their parking lot to welcome people in so that they could trick them into joining a conversion therapy program. People have learned that, like, if I do these actions, I can lure people in, right? That's the fear people have. I believe that doing and going through RIC vets a lot of that out, right? And says, if someone's trying to be that pernicious, but it also means then you have to be that like visible and vocal and let people know what kind of Christians we are, what kind of Lutherans we are, and what we believe and how we're gonna live that out. The other thing I will say about RIC is that I, thanks Bishop Jake, is that I lost my train of thought with this. You threw me off, Rick. Give me a second, I'll come back. Nope, it's gone. Sorry.
Well, if I can add, I joined a Lutheran church because it had the RIC. I had never heard about that, but I saw that like nomenclature stuff and learned about it. And I'm like, oh, this is great. And so, you know, even if you do not have any queer people in your congregation, 80% of your congregation says, we feel good about this. This makes us feel good about the church we belong to. We agree with the direction the church is going. 80% said that, right? Mm-hmm. So those people feel good about the church. And the church I went to, I honestly don't know if there was any gay couples or queer people in the church, but I know my child at the time was questioning, so it felt like a good place for me. I later came to find out another lady, you know, my age, she has a trans parent, right? And so, you know, even, you know, this has been an RIC church for years before I came. Not any, you know, strong gay, queer presence within the congregation, but I think there were people and families who are connected to a loved one who is in that community who say, I can feel good about showing up at this church, and my family member can come to this church when they're visiting me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'll say this too. So this is my day job with GLAAD. We do a lot of this corporate stuff. However, I think it can be really helpful for our churches too. If you don't know this, Gallup, there's not really a good polling on like LGBTQ people, but Gallup has been the number that I've used the most. As of a month ago, the number of people that Americans that identify as lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, or something other than heterosexual has been increasing steadily and now is at 7.6% of Americans. In 2012, it was like 3.5%. However, of Gen Z, that number is 22.3%, more than one in five. We're nearly at a quarter. And that's only half of Gen Z, because polling gets complicated when you get under 18 years of age. And of course, there's Gen Alpha under them too, that's even younger. One of the cases that we make corporately is that the young generation, the group that I target for youth ministry, are more likely to be LGBTQ. They're more likely to know somebody who's LGBTQ, which also means they're probably more likely to support LGBTQ people. And Gen Z is also very values driven. And they will they won't often help you fix it. They'll just walk away if they think the institution is not being helpful. This is being seen on a corporate level where they want brands that they believe are standing up for their values. And I hate thinking of the church as a brand because it rolls my eyes really hard like that. But when I think of reputation, is that a trusted institution? Is that one that young people say, this is a place that stands up for the same values that I believe in? And that's LGBTQ. That is otherwise. You'll see that we do some polling data with it right now too, and it's probably intuitive as well. It's true with LGBTQ. It's true with immigration. It's true with the environment. You can see a very big break in young voters. Israel and Gaza has been something that Gen Z is much more vocal, much more active on, and probably will impact the way that they vote or don't vote. And that may supersede other things like environment or LGBTQ or other things. We still have to wait and see what that's going to look like and what that's going to be like. But like, don't sleep on this generation. They are already doing so much of this stuff. They really strongly believe in it. They wear their values on their sleeve. They'll talk about it. They'll profess it. And we can be a part of that and support that, or we can roll our eyes and say, kids these days. But it's going to spend a lot of time in like that listening. And I think that's also going to be one of those things that RIC can position us to be able to do, but that'll take additional work.
I actually was given some statistics in pediatrics about the younger Gen Z and the generation after, which I think is
Gen Alpha.
Alpha, that a third are non-binary. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think if we're going to, be meaningful as the church to younger generations, we are obligated to, take a stand.
Mm-hmm. I think that's Trevor Project data, because they put of LGBTQ youth, I think it is a third of them see themselves as non-binary, and non-binary is a newer term. Like, the definition for it's a little hazy, and some people use it, it means different things when people use it. This creates a headache for a lot of people, including at GLAAD, where everyone wants us to have a very clean, clear definition of something. That does mean, and again, I want to say this is not because there's something in the water. If I have to defend myself, it is not because anyone is making them that. One of the things that I've been doing has taken up my last 48 hours is, I know that I do some back channel work with Pope Francis, and the statement that came up from the Vatican on the things that are a threat to human dignity, and including, they didn't say transgender people, but they said gender ideology, gender theory, gender change. I think they also included in that list too, has been one of those that I'm really trying to like manage a response for. And figure out how to try to backtrack and guide that into a slightly better direction. But that is also, no one is doing this to them, but we are all hearing anti-LGBT stories about how someone is trying to force that into somebody else. And these stories just stick around. I had a friend, good friend, texting on it like, well, I still don't think they should be doing surgeries on children. Nobody's doing surgeries on children. Like, I want to be super, super clear about that. But at most, they are accepting the child, calling them by names and pronouns, probably also giving them a lot of counseling and therapy too, because you can't do a lot of gender change stuff without a lot of counseling and therapy, and nothing is being done on a whim. And even the things that are being done are not permanent life-changing stuff, but salacious stories go around, they scare people, and people are highly, highly motivated by fear. It's sad. I wish we were all motivated by love, but fear is a really strong motivator. And so it takes a lot of work for us to continue to voice that in as many different ways as possible for the larger public, for the people that need to hear it, for the people that need to hear it for their own affirmation, and for everybody else who needs to hear it for their own education. And GLAAD has to straddle that all the time. Like, is our audience the LGBTQ community that needs to hear this affirmation, or is our audience the people that need to learn and grow? And we call them the movable middle. And we kind of go back and forth between those two audiences constantly.
Thank you so much, Ross. I really, really appreciate this conversation.
Of course.
And thank you to all of you for being here. It was great.
Yeah, you all made this conversation what it is. So thank you.
Thank you.
And I'll see you in 6 weeks.
Yes, I look forward to, well, we'll see you unless we come to the GLAAD training.
That's, oh yeah. If you say, oh yeah, then you're seeing me in like 2 weeks. So come to the GLAAD training, and that's, well, you'll see my whole team doing their amazing stuff.
And if y'all need any information about that, email me and I'll be happy to get you whatever information you need.
Thank you, Allison.
My absolute pleasure.
Thank you.
Have a good night, everybody.
Have a wonderful evening. Thank you again.